Good afternoon, all. Thank you for joining us for the great lecture. I'm Taft Armandroff. I'm the director of McDonald Observatory, and it's my honor to introduce my colleague, Shardha Jogee, to give the presentation today, Galaxies, Science and Society, Breakthroughs and New Directions. Shardha is the Rex G. Baker Jr. and McDonald Observatory Centennial Professor of Astronomy. Shardha holds a bachelor's degree in physics from the University of Cambridge in England and a master's and PhD from Yale University. Shardha was a postdoc at Caltech and then at the Space Telescope Science Institute, and she came to the University of Texas at Austin after her two postdocs. Shardha is an expert, as you've probably gathered, in the formation and evolution of galaxies, all their constituent parts, their stars, their gas, their black holes, and how do they evolve over the lifetime of the universe. Shardha is also active in leadership. She was the chair of our Department of Astronomy from 2015 to 2019. And over that time period, Shardha did a great job diversifying the faculty and adding really great new faculty to our program. She's also done some other really interesting things beyond her teaching and research, and I'd call attention to the fact that she's been an op-ed fellow and is interested in and active in linking science and society. So without further ado, I'd like to turn the virtual podium over to Shardha, and I'm sure you're all really going to enjoy her talk today.
Okay, great. Thank you, Taft, very much for this kind introduction. And also thank you for inviting me to give the annual great lecture for our Board of Visitors. I'm very happy to do this, and to our members of the board, I would say welcome. And I have really missed interacting with you all in person, getting together over dinner, brainstorming about science, and getting energized by your enthusiasm for science. So I hope we can resume those activities soon. And in the meantime, I hope this lecture, you know, can bridge the gap a little bit. And I know this lecture is also open to the broader UT community and the public. So to everybody else who might be attending, welcome to you all. I hope everybody will enjoy our little journey, I would say, today through the universe. And I will start my talk now. Lara, I'm going to start sharing my screen. So let me just see if this works here. Okay. Can everybody see my screen? Great. Okay.
It's the full desktop. There you go. Okay.
So my talk today, as Taft mentioned, is about galaxy science and society. And I have a lot of collaborators, research collaborators, that I would like to acknowledge at the beginning of this presentation. So individual collaborators from all over the world, but particularly graduate students who have worked in our research group. Also large survey teams we have collaborated with to do some of the biggest surveys of galaxies across the universe. And also a number of theory collaborators that we have worked with. Our group, our work is primarily observational, but we do like to compare predictions, theoretical predictions, with observation, and you will see quite a bit in this talk. So thank you to everybody who's helped. So I'm going to start with a brief introduction to galaxies. So I would say, seminal questions about our origin. Are we alone? Are we unique? Where are we going? These kind of questions have been at the focus of our civilization for a long time. They still are. And the field of galaxy has also had these very these raging debates about similar issues. So although Immanuel Kant in the early 1700, mid 1700, already pondered about whether external galaxies, galaxies other than our Milky Way, exist as island universes, most people didn't really believe that. They thought our galaxy, the Milky Way, was the only galaxy out there. And as late as 1920, the great debate between Shapley and Curtis centered on the issue of, are these faint spiral nebulae we see on the sky, are these external galaxies, or are they just part of the Milky Way? And today we actually know for a fact that over a billion galaxies exist in our universe as part of a rich cosmic web. And I'm going to show you this animation, which is actually from real data. The Sloan Digital Sky Survey, SDSS, has observed the local universe, large fraction of the sky. And this is actual data from them. And you can see as we move around in the local universe, you see a diverse tapestry of galaxies, diverse galaxies. You see hints of cosmological filament and the cosmic web. So clearly, no, we are not alone, and there's many, many external galaxies out there. Now, what are galaxies, and you know, why should we bother to study them? So in its simplest description, galaxies are made of luminous component. Let me just click my window here. Okay. So they are made of luminous components, stars, gas, and dust. And they're also made of a dark component called dark matter. And the whole, all these components are bound by gravity into one structure that we call a galaxy. And typical stellar masses of galaxies today range from 100 million to 10 to the 12. So that's 100 billion solar mass. And that's just the star, the stellar component. Most of the mass is actually in dark matter. So that's 80% of the mass that we are not seeing that is above and beyond these numbers I have just shown you. And galaxies, I think, are interesting in their own right. And that's what I'm going to be talking to you about the rest of the talk. But for a lot of people, galaxies are also interesting because they trace the dark component of the universe that we call dark matter and dark energy. So if you look at the energy budget of the universe or mass budget, they're interchangeable to some degree, you find that 68% of the universe is made of dark energy, 27% is made of dark matter, and to be precise, this should be called non-baryonic dark matter, which means it's not made of ordinary atoms, it's exotic to some degree, so it's non-ordinary, that's what non-baryonic means. So that's about 27%. And then we have 5% here, which is ordinary matter, atoms. They are made of baryons, neutron, protons. And of that 5%, 0.5% is luminous. It emits electromagnetic radiation at different wavelengths, so we can actually measure its light. All the images you will see in this talk actually are from that 0.5%. Then there's 4.5%, that's just ordinary dark matter. So it is still made of atoms, but it is dark, it doesn't emit light, and these are your familiar black hole, brown dwarf, neutron star. So to me, it has always been absolutely remarkable that we actually trace this 0.5%, that is what we observe. And yet we can use that 0.5% through our knowledge of physics to infer these other two components, which make up 90% of the universe. And in fact, I would say most of what we know about dark matter come from galaxies. They come from the flat rotation curve of galaxies, so the circular speed against radius, it's flat. This was first brought to light by Vera Rubin and established very firm evidence for dark matter. We've also known about dark matter on larger scale between galaxies by looking at gravitational lensing, where we see these arc of light that are basically the lensing effect of a background object by the dark matter in the cluster of galaxies. But beyond showing us that dark matter exists, galaxies have also told us a lot about the nature of this dark matter. In fact, the strongest constraint on what is this dark matter come from observation of different bound structures, supercluster of galaxies, which are really big, 10 megaparsec. This cluster here is about 2 megaparsec. This is 10, so much, much bigger. These galaxies, supercluster, the biggest bound structures in the universe, are only seen at very late time. But low mass systems are actually seen at early time. And this kind of prediction comes directly from models where the dark matter is called cold dark matter rather than hot dark matter. Now, that would be a lecture on its own to talk about the different models of dark matter. But the main point I want you to get here is that galaxies have shown us dark matter exists, and they have even constrained the nature of dark matter. And I'm not going to talk much more about dark matter and dark energy in this talk. I'm going to focus on the galaxies themselves, but I think this gives you some perspective of what else you can do with galaxies. So for the rest of this talk, there are some important concepts that I would like to get across. So I would ask for your attention here, because this what I say here will really help you understand a lot of what I'm going to say later. So if you look in the universe today and you ask, what are the three main types of galaxies we see, you know, around us? The first kind is called a spiral galaxy. And a spiral galaxy is like a frisbee. It has a large flat outer disk where the stars are rotating. And in the center, there's a bulgy component. And then it's actively forming stars. And by the way, throughout this talk, you will see kiloparsec, parsec, and so on. Just remember, a parsec is about 3 light years. And our own Milky Way is actually a spiral galaxy. You're just seeing it from the side. So beyond spiral galaxies, the other main kind of galaxies we see in the universe are elliptical galaxies. Elliptical galaxies are like a watermelon. They're like a ball. They are very puffed up. The stars have lots of random motion, and they are not forming new stars. You can see basically all the stars are dead. And then the third kind of galaxies are interacting galaxies. These are galaxies colliding together. We'll talk about their physics in a bit. Now, to really visualize elliptical galaxy, my 12-year-old Anne, whom many of the BOV members know, yesterday made a little model of a spiral galaxy, and I would like to show it to you. But I think this would require me to stop sharing my PowerPoint and hopefully you can see her model. So can you spotlight me, Lara? Okay, fantastic. So here is Anne's model of a spiral galaxy, the Frisbee. So if you look at it from the side, I hope you can all see it's very thin. It's like a pancake. And the stuff in red in the middle that's bulging out, that's what we call the bulge of a spiral galaxy. So you're looking at it from the side. That's the picture of the Milky Way I showed you from the side. Very thin disk, pancake-like structure, and a bulge. If you turn it and look at it face on, this is where the name spiral galaxy comes. So you have a bulge, you have a bar, we will talk about bar, and then you have a spiral arm, okay? So this artistic thing, I thank my daughter Anne for making this for you yesterday, and I would not be forgiven for not showing it, because it's very instructive, because you can really see. The elliptical galaxy is a balloon. So just think of it as a balloon, very different. I can't show the balloon efficiently, but I think you can visualize a balloon. So one is a frisbee, one is a balloon. That's all you need to really think of in terms of how different these galaxies are. So now I will try to share my screen again. Okay, we can see. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great. I just wanted to make sure the transition went fine. So you now have a good idea of how galaxies look like. And I'm now going to tell you what kind of question we are going to address in this talk. So in this slide here, I'm going to try to explain what my research is about, and that's what we will talk about today, what my group is doing. So this is a cosmic timeline. It shows the universe. This is the early universe. You had Big Bang, inflation, you had the dark ages, you had the first stars. And then around this time here, you had the development of the first proto-galaxies. These look like nothing like what we see today. They are small, clumpy, irregular, and they don't look like any of these beautiful galaxies that we have today. And these galaxies, these mini galaxies, they build up over time till today. So in this picture, today is here, early universe is here. Now, so my group studies galaxy growth over this 80% of cosmic time. How do we do that? Well, we look back in time at epochs when the universe was younger. And throughout this talk, you're going to hear things like redshift, redshift zero, redshift one. So all you need to remember is that redshift is basically a way to talk about look back time, TB here. When redshift is zero, we are talking about today. When redshift is one, cosmology tells us look back time is 7 billion years ago. And that's about 50% of cosmic history. So we are looking back to, let's say, about here. When redshift is two, the look back time becomes bigger. You're looking back 10 billion years in time, okay? So the redshift zero is today. Redshift one, we are looking back here. Redshift two, we are looking back here. So by redshift two, although the number is small, we're actually looking back 70% of cosmic history. And so the question that keep me awake at night are how do we grow and transform galaxies over 70% of cosmic history, right? So over this period, how do we go from these tiny irregular galaxies to these beautiful, virialized, massive elliptical and spiral we see today? And what role did violent processes like galaxy collision play versus what we called secular, slower processes? And what role did environment play? Just like in normal life, what happens in a city center versus the countryside is environment, and it impacts the kind of processes at play. So what about galaxies? What does environment do? And also I'm going to talk about central supermassive black hole. How do they relate to their galaxies and how do they impact the growth of galaxies? The 2020 Nobel Prize in Physics, I will remind you, was for the firm, a demonstration of a supermassive compact object in the center of our own galaxy, and that object is believed to be a supermassive black hole. Okay, so how do I go about answering these questions? Galaxy growth is a complex process, and I will first illustrate this with this simulation. We are going to start early in the universe, and then we are going to grow a galaxy that looks like our Milky Way, okay? And you will see that as this galaxy grows and it becomes like the Milky Way, there are many, many processes at play. You will see gas accretion along filaments. You will see galaxy merging with each other. You will see stellar bars. You will see star formation happening, the gas being converted into stars. And then you don't really see the feedback so much here, but this will become an important term that you will learn about later. All of these interplay together to give you galaxy growth. So let's start here. So here we are looking very, very early in the universe. We have an overdensity that's a deep potential well. It attracts other clumps and masses. So this potential well becomes bigger. You get a more massive object. You start to have more and more massive object conglomerate here. So the gas is starting to build in. The gas is starting to form stars. The new stars is this color here. So you can see you have star formation. You're starting to form like a disk, your frisbee. You're starting to form a bulge in the middle. You are starting to have galaxies ripping into each other. That's galaxy mergers. You're starting to have spiral arm develop. It's starting to look like a galaxy that looks like today, right? So qualitatively, it looks like all of these processes, at least for a galaxy like the Milky Way, are very relevant. So now you might ask me, well, haven't you answered your question already? Just run simulation and you can answer how to build galaxy and how to grow galaxies. But simulations just provide you this theoretical simulation. They provide you with just a qualitative guide. And why is that? The reason that is because with our cold dark matter cosmology, we can really make very good prediction about dark matter, because modeling dark matter just requires you to know the forces of gravity. So this is a millennium simulation here. This is predicting the distribution of dark matter on large scales. And if you actually match that distribution to light, so on large scale, you can pretty much reproduce the distribution of dark matter and the distribution of light on very large scale, much larger than galaxy sizes. However, modeling galaxies is much harder because not only do you need to know the dark matter part, you need to model that. You also need to model gas, stars and dust. Those are called baryons. Those, modeling those is a very, very tricky process. You have to model different gas phase called hot, warm. You have to know under what condition the gas forms stars. You have to know about feedback. Right now, this doesn't mean anything to you. It will become clear later what I mean. You need to understand bars and mergers. So observations are really needed. The simulation can predict, frankly, anything, but you need this boundary condition from observations. It's a constant interplay between data and models in terms of constraining models, in terms of advancing models. So now I'm going to tell you a little bit about bars and mergers before showing you our results, so you kind of understand, you know, why these things are important. So stellar bars and how they impact galaxies. So first, what is a bar, you might ask? Well, most galaxies, including our Milky Way, have a bar. So a bar is this elongated feature that you see in a disk, right? This is the bulge. Remember, that's the donut thing that was in the middle of Ann's model. This is the bar. And at the end of the bar, spiral arms come out. So a bar is made of stars. It's just an elongated feature. So why do we care? Why is it important? Well, it's important because it is the most efficient way of taking gas from the outer disk of a galaxy and driving it to the center. So if you look carefully here, you will see the straight dark lane here and a dark lane here. These are shocks. The bar exerts force of gravity on the gas. It also shocks it, and the gas travels along this path here, and then it ends up here. So bars basically are the most efficient way to drive gas from a disk into the central region, and then it can feed, can produce star at very, very high rates here, 100 times faster than our Milky Way. It can build a bulge. We believe this is how bulges are built. And if you have a central black hole, a million solar mass black hole sitting right at the center, the bar doesn't get the gas all the way to the black hole, but it gets it 2/3 of the way. And so it partially helps if other things can then take the gas and move it a little bit further in. So bars are super important in driving gas in. And I'm going to show you a little simulation here from François Combe from the Paris Observatory. So if you on this side, you have a disk. It doesn't have a bar yet, you will notice. The disk is, this side shows stars, this side shows gas, okay? So you can see that the stars are all distributed in a sphere. They are not, there's no bars here. But this disk is massive and it's also cold, meaning there's not much random motion. These two conditions can produce bar. And so when I run the simulation, you're first going to see a bar form here after a little bit. And then that bar will take the gas and drive it to the center. Notice how it's spread around the gases. At the end of the simulation, most of that gas will be in this region. So let's start it here, okay? You start to have spiral arm at first, and then you will be seeing soon a bar. Look, that oval feature forming here, that's a bar. It is starting to drive. Look at where the gas is going. Look at how much of that gas is getting to the center. Okay. So at the end, look how little of the gas is left in the disk. Most of that gas has been channeled to the center because of the bar. Okay, so that shows you the efficiency of bars in driving the central region, gas into the central region. So that's all I'm going to say about bars themselves. And now I'm going to talk to you about galaxy mergers. Galaxy mergers happen when things merge, when a galaxy merges with another galaxy. They get stuck together and they become a new system. So we talk about two kinds of mergers, major merger and minor merger in galaxy evolution. And as the name suggests, a minor merger is just when a galaxy merges with something much less massive than itself. So usually something 1/4 or 1/10 of its mass. So big guy gobble a little guy. And the main thing I want you to remember is that if there's a minor merger, the disk of the spiral is not destroyed. It gets messed up, yes, but it's not destroyed. And so in this simulation I'm going to run here, it's a galaxy. It will have a companion come in. You have gas here, you have stars, you have edge-on view, you have face-on view. And there are a couple of things that will happen. I'm just going to list them here so you can actually watch out. You will see a stellar bow will be induced in the stars here. That bow will drive gas inflow, just like you saw before. So the gas will start to go in. The disk will thicken. Look at how thin the disk is. It will become thick. And we see a thick disk in our own Milky Way. And the satellite will sink to the center after a while. It just is going to be gobbled up. So watch out for these four things in the simulation. So the companion comes close by. Look, a bar has been induced in both, right? Look at that bar there. That bar is starting to drive gas in. So gas here, the gas distribution becomes more centrally concentrated. The companion is still bound by gravity here. So it keeps coming back. And eventually it is going to be eaten up because its speed is less than the escape speed. Those of you who are in my class, if you are here, you will have done this calculation. And notice how thick that disk has become at the end. Ask me if you want to know why. So the important thing is, look, the disk is still here. It has been messed up, but it's still here. So you don't destroy your disk. Now, this is an actual galaxy, which has suffered a minor merger. And this is a galaxy I mapped during my thesis at Yale. And it's the result of a minor merger where a big spiral galaxy has eaten a small one. The disk has survived, clearly the disk is here, but there are clear signs of the crime, if you want to call it that. There are ripples and there are arcs in the disk. It doesn't look like an undisturbed disk. There's a whopping 20 kiloparsec tail here. And through modeling and further observation, we found that this little guy here is not a star. It's the nucleus of that small galaxy that actually got stripped. So this is the nucleus of the small galaxy, that's its outer region. And there is a whopping 50 kiloparsec tail here, twice as big in gas. I haven't shown it, but if you want, you can ask me and I can show it to you. It's pretty spectacular. So this is a minor merger. What about a major merger? That's the other kind of galaxy collision that happens. So in a major merger, as the name suggests, the galaxy is actually merging, not with a little guy, but with a guy similar, with a galaxy of comparable mass. Either equal mass or one third of its mass. So the dramatic thing that happens there is if a spiral galaxy has a major merger with another galaxy, it is radically transformed. Its outer disk, the frisbee basically, is destroyed and the star gets redistributed to form an elliptical galaxy. And this happens through a process called violent relaxation, which again, if you're interested, ask me. But this is pretty astounding. You are going from a frisbee, a pancake, into something that looks like a watermelon. And for the longest time until the 1970s, astronomers did not understand that you can go from disks into elliptical. And this was a major, major breakthrough when we realized this could happen. So now let me show you this happening. So again, this is a simulation. Now the two galaxies are similar mass, the stars are yellow, the gas is blue. And I will again tell you what to watch out in this simulation. So first, as usual, you will get bars induced in both of these. They will drive their gas in, do their thing, produce stars in the center. Then suddenly violent relaxation is going to kick in. It will destroy this disk and it will form this, it will redistribute this star into kind of a puffed watermelon configuration like an elliptical galaxy. It will give the stars lots of random motion. So watch out for this in the simulation. So at the end, you get something that has nothing to do with spiral galaxies. Okay, gravity pulls them together. You have long tail to conserve angular momentum for those of you who are physics students. Of course, this shifting is just to show you what's happening. The nature doesn't do that. Violent relaxation is kicking in. Look at how these disks are starting to be destroyed and you are getting a 3D configuration. Okay, that is not a frisbee we are seeing here. So that keeps happening. It gets more and more spherical. And at the end, it doesn't quite look exactly like an elliptical yet. It's starting to get there, but this simulation was only run for a billion years if you run it a bit longer. Okay, so now you might say, well, this is just a model. It has nothing to do with nature. How do you know it's true? So a colleague of mine at the Frank Summers, who works at NASA, he did this amazing comparison where he takes this simulation and then he looks out in the universe and he has real galaxy snapshots. And you will see that basically these different stages of the merger that you show actually happen in nature. So here, this is the simulation. We are just looking at a different orientation. This is an actual pair of galaxies observed with the Hubble. Okay, you continue the simulation. Things are starting to pull together, shocks, star formation. You turn the orientation and lo and behold, this matches observed real galaxies. And you continue. Okay, so you get the idea. There's a pretty close match between what we see in the simulation and at least qualitatively between the appearance of galaxies. Of course, the details we may or may not get right. And before I leave major mergers, I want to let you know there's one coming your way very soon. Well, soon in quote, our own Milky Way and Andromeda are close together and they have similar masses. So if they merge, it's a major merger. And models suggest that they are coming close together and in 6 billion years, they will merge. So we will all be, you know, well, we, not we, I don't think we will be here in 6 billion years, but whoever is here will definitely, all the stars that are in the Milky Way will be impacted by this in terms of their orbits. So here's the Milky Way. This is a simulation, this is billion years from now. So the Andromeda galaxy, and it is M33 is part of this group here with Andromeda. So Andromeda starts to move towards the Milky Way. Now they're going to come back together because gravity is acting and violent relaxation will start to kick in now. Okay, you don't have a disk in your Milky Way anymore. We are starting to become an elliptical galaxy. Okay, and this process, this merger will continue to happen, but in 6 billion years, there's no Milky Way anymore. Okay. So those are the some interesting concepts and some observations. Now I want to tell you a little bit what we have done in our group looking at the universe over 50% of cosmic history. And let me just check the time here. Okay, good. To do this, we use a survey called GEMS that was done with the Hubble Space Telescope. And I want to explain a little bit to you how surveys work, because I told you we looked back in time. How can we look back in time? So in this little cartoon here from NASA, we have the present day universe is on this side now. This is today. You have this elliptical and spiral. This is the Big Bang. So as we look back in time, we are looking back like this. This is the numbers here are the age of the universe. Look back time is basically a different concept. It's how far back we look. So different survey, if they are deep or shallow, can look back to different epochs, right? So today, as we said, the universe is 13.7 billion years. And if we look at distant galaxies, they act like time machine. And the reason for that is kind of simple. Light that is reaching us today from a galaxy, it's not light that has left the galaxy now. It's light that left the galaxy many billion years ago. That light needed time to reach us. So the picture we get is not how the galaxy looks today. It's how the galaxy looked like TB billion years ago. And so what the GEMS survey does is it probes faint galaxies and it allows us to look back at an epoch when the universe, it looks back 7 billion years. So that's half of the age of the universe. So what was GEMS? When we did GEMS, which has been done in 2004, and then it's been continuously, you know, updated and added observation. It was the, at the time, it was the biggest survey done with the NASA's Hubble Space Telescope. And the area that we covered was 30 by 30 arc minute. It's the size of the moon. We don't observe the moon, but the size of the moon is just shown here for reference. Previously, before this survey, the biggest one that had been done was the Hubble Deep Field, which was tiny. And so you can see the size of the Hubble Deep Field compared to the size of this survey. And compared to the Hubble Ultra Deep Field, which is another survey done 10 years later, it is still bigger. So Hubble is important because it gives us superb high resolution images. So we can see structure like bars and double nuclei and tails. We also use the NASA Spitzer and Chandra facility to find out how we are making star formation and what the black hole is. And then we also use ground-based data to get redshift, to look back in time. And I'm going to show you a little montage now that kind of hits home the power of high resolution images. This is the Hubble Deep Field that I talk about that was done before. That's the size of the Hubble Deep Field. That's the size of the moon. This is the size of the survey. So you can clearly see surveys much bigger than earlier surveys. Now I'm going to show you the Hubble observation. So I'm going to take a slice of this survey and we're going to zoom in. Okay, so that's just 1/3 of the survey. Doesn't look very impressive, right? Bunch of dots. But now if you actually start to zoom in, look, you can see how much information you get from this data. Clearly emerging system. You can learn about so much physics in here with all this information. Same thing here, double galaxies, double nuclei, an ongoing merger. You have them big galaxies, they are forefront system, they are nearby spiral, but look here, there's something happening here. This is spectacular because most of the galaxies here are galaxies that are present half of the age of the universe. Almost all of them happen to be so. So pretty amazing. When the universe was half of its age, you still had spiral. Spiral galaxies were already in place. They were not as massive as today, but they were in place already. The backbone of the Hubble sequence was here. So what did we find? The first major result we found is that barred galaxies like our Milky Way are not unique. They have been present, they are present over half of the cosmic history. Now, prior to our work, the previous study that had been done said, if you look halfway back in the universe, 50% of cosmic history, you have zero bars. The bar fraction was zero. And so we were surprised, we found lots of bars, and the fraction of galaxies with bars is anywhere between 20 to 30%. So that was a major result. You might say, but who cares? Well, the reason it's important is because this shows that bars have been around for at least 7 billion years. And if they have been around for 7 billion years, that means they play an important role in galaxy evolution. They can drive gas in for 7 billion years. They can form stars, they can build bulge. And so this mode of evolution called secular evolution was not considered important until we found this, because it then said, oh, great, it actually is here, it is acting. The next thing we found, there were four major results, is, well, most massive galaxies that we are looking at, you know, they are not interacting. They all look pretty regular, non-interacting, virialized, symmetric. Now, that's not to say interacting galaxies are not there. They are there and they're pretty spectacular, but there are not many of them. So let me show you a few of them. As you can see, they look really spectacular because of the Hubble's resolution. You can see all the details here. You have this one clearly minor. This one, we call it the tadpole. We have no clue what happened to it because it's a late merger. So we don't really know what merged together, but clearly very messed up. This is a disk. It's gotten warped like our own Milky Way. So it's not a major merger, it's probably a minor merger remnant. Then you have train wrecks, you have ongoing interaction, you have, these are very interesting systems, they're called dry mergers because they are ellipticals merging. So they're all, everything I told you about gas forming stars, none of this has happened. You will just have violent relaxation, you will get a bigger ball, but these are rare because most systems have gas at that epoch. So this one, for some reason, it has finished using all its gas. So three major results about mergers. The first is you kind of heard me. So this is merger rate, this is epoch, right? So this is looking back in time, this is today, this is half of cosmic history. And these are our data point, the stars. So the first thing we found, and I implied it already, we have mergers are rare. low merger fraction. We also found minor mergers at least three times as frequent as major mergers. So this was the first study that showed that, and it was confirmed 2 years later by Jennifer Lotz in 2011. And very interestingly, we found, we compared with theory. All of these lines that you see here are theoretical model, the star or hour point. So immediately you will see some models are 3 to 4 times higher than the data, some are 3 to 4 times lower. So across the model, there's a factor of greater than 6 variation. Although we had made all the theorists use the same definition of majors, use the same time scale and so on. So they were very stunned to see that despite the similar normalization, there's such a big difference. So the nice thing, as I said, when data and theory interplay is that the theorists then later got together without us as the observers, and they wrote a separate paper where they compared all their models in detail and they realized what was the problem and they improved the way they model mergers. So my philosophy is this is always how you advance science. Then I would say the result that was most stunning to us, and we hesitated for a long time to decide, do we publish this? Could we be wrong? And here's the question we were trying to answer. This is a very famous plot in astronomy. It's called the cosmic star formation history. This is the rate of star formation. This is looking back in time. So this is today. This is redshift 1, which you remember is halfway back in time. So you will see this curve decline very steeply. And that means the star formation activity in the universe from galaxies is dramatically declining in the last 7 billion years. And for a long time, it was thought around, you know, in the early 2000s, well, this is probably because mergers are decreasing. You had tons of mergers here. They were producing lots of stars. And then now we don't have many mergers. So that's why. But that's what all the textbooks said. But this is not at all what we found. And basically what we found is even now, even here, looking at early time, mergers were not the thing driving star formation. So here is the actual result showing that. So this has a lot of information, but don't be scared. It's kind of, you can ignore the lower two panel. They just have different methods. Just focus on the top panel. So the y-axis tells you how much star formation is happening. The x-axis is looking back in time. So the thing to notice here is the black is the total amount of star formation rate in all galaxies. The orange is how much of that star formation is from mergers. And the green is how much of the star formation is not from mergers. It's from normal, non-interacting galaxy. So clearly it jumps at you. The yellow, the green line and the black line are together, which means non-interacting galaxy are doing most of the star formation and they are accounting for most of the total star formation. Mergers happen, but they're almost, you know, between 3 and 10 times producing less stars. So this was surprising to us because, as I said, the textbook explanation was that mergers were driving star formation here. And then by the time we would get to here, there wouldn't be many mergers. But even here, you can see mergers are not doing most of the work. So we concluded that visible mergers account only for 1/3 of the star formation rate density. And therefore, over the last 50% of cosmic history, the universe has already transitioned to a phase where it's not a violent place anymore. Most stars are formation are happening in normal galaxy. It's not dominated by violent galaxy mergers. And this result, we tried it in 6 different ways. We got the same result. I've shown you 3 ways here. And it was confirmed the subsequent years by Robena et al. 2010. So we were glad we were not, you know, wrong. but that's the nature of science. You are very much surprised. Okay. So now I would like to talk very briefly about black holes in galaxies. What is a black hole? The idea of black hole was proposed very early, and it was mostly like a mathematical concept until astronomers started to realize maybe black hole exists in nature. And the simplest view of a black hole is any sphere of mass M can become a black hole if you compress it into such a small radius that the radius is less than the Schwarzschild radius. The Schwarzschild radius is just the radius where the gravitational field will be so strong that even light cannot escape. And that's why black holes are called black, because light cannot escape. Now, the Schwarzschild radius, don't worry about the detail here, but this is the equation. So if you wanted to become a black hole, you could become one, provided you compress your mass to the value indicated here. So for a human being with mass 60, this is the radius that you would have to become to be a black hole. Okay, so I don't recommend trying this at home, even if you love black hole, it's smaller than an atom. If you have 100 million solar mass, how much would you have to compress it? Well, 10 to the minus 5 parsec. A parsec is 3 light years, remember. And look at this radius here. So M31 has a mass, supermassive black hole, 100 million solar masses. This number is telling you that 100 million solar mass black hole is right there in the center. This is 15,000 parsec. The black hole is in 10 to the minus 5 parsec. So it's a dot. And most galaxies host a supermassive black hole. Current observing facility cannot actually get down to the Schwarzschild radius. But in 2019, we had an event happen that most astronomers, I think, cried looking at this image. And so here's what happened. Einstein's theory tells you that if you have a black hole, you will get a black hole shadow whose diameter is not Schwarzschild radius, it's 5 times. So it's a bit bigger. And for M87, if you do the calculation, this is 40 microarc second. The Event Horizon Telescope, which used the entire Earth really as a dish, it's an interferometer, just about reached this value. And so for the very first time in the history of astronomy, we had an image of the black hole. This is the black hole shadow. This is light that is lensed back. And this diameter is 5 Schwarzschild radius. And so this led to the Science Breakthrough Prize of 2019. And to me, it's one of, I was teaching black hole when this happened, and it was amazing that I could actually say, well, we now know for sure black hole exists. The 2020 Nobel Prize in Physics was for the black hole in the center of our Milky Way. And so this was done by Andrea Ghez, who mapped the orbit of stars for 15 years. This is the orb, you trace this, the motion of the stars. And the black hole is sitting here, which means it makes stars move very, very quickly when they come near it. So this star SO16 and SO2, just watch them. And here. So for these observation and the data and the analysis, Andrea Ghez and Reinhard Genzel and Roger Penrose, he got it for more theoretical, but these two got it for the demonstration of a supermassive black hole in our Milky Way. So galaxies and black hole, I wanted to mention, they also have a relationship with each other. We found that black hole and bulge masses correlate with each other, which is super surprising because a bulge is this big and a black hole is a dot. So how come they grow in tandem? And the explanation given, one explanation is that, well, they don't exert gravity on each other, but what if the same events fuel them, allow their black hole to grow and the bulge to grow? So you could imagine a galaxy merger would do that. It would channel gas in, it would grow the bulge, it would also grow the black hole. But it's not that simple. You also have to stop the growth of the black hole together. So that is something not so easy to do. But that's one of the proposed explanation. And how do you grow black hole? Well, growing the black hole requires two things. It requires enough gas and then some way to get the gas to the black hole. So you may have the gas you need here, but you need to bring it to the center. So I'm not going to go into detail here, but I have written a review in this book, chapter 6, that talks about all the different ways to drive the gas in. And I think I will just skip that for now, but just know it's very difficult in an isolated galaxy because there's no single mechanism, but in a major merger, it's pretty easy. So I think that's the bottom line. So now I'm about to show you our final result. And that ties to the light from the black hole and the feedback. So as mass is piling on the black hole, of course, mass that goes very close, it will be eaten up. There will be no light. But mass tends to come on an accretion disk around the black hole, which is about here, right? And as the mass piles in, you have light emitted. So you have radiation, you have winds, you also have jets. And the important thing that I want you to get out of this is when we talk about things called quasar, they are the black holes that are eating at the fastest rate. So they are the most they emit most light because the mass that is falling in is falling the fastest. And they eat at the rate of 1 to 100 solar mass per year. That's a very, very hungry black hole there. The other thing you will hear in AGN, in black hole science, AGN feedback. What AGN feedback means is the AGN is saying, I don't want to grow anymore, so I'm going to fight the growth. And how do they fight it? Well, they fight it with the jets. They fight it with other winds here that are not shown. And it's not really clear whether AGN feedback works. That's a major, major problem in galaxy evolution. All the theoretical models put it in, because if they don't put it in, their galaxies grow way too big. But observationally, we don't have that much evidence that AGN feedback is happening. So I'm going to show you a merger that where there is now this AGN feedback, and you will notice it does stop the growth of the galaxy. But I think it's too much because you will see it almost blows the galaxy away. So it's the same as a merger you saw before. Now the difference is that you will have AGN feedback. You will have wind and jets from the AGN at the end will start to eject stuff, blow stuff out. Now, did you see here? It's starting to blow, each black hole is blowing stuff out. And now when it merges, you get a second black hole, a combined black hole with accretion disk, you blow things out very quickly. Okay, so that's how simulators put black hole feedback. We don't know if it's real. We suspect it's not quite right. So now I'm going to show you two results that actually address this picture. Can you grow the black hole and the bulge together? And is AGN feedback working or not? And so this result, actually, I'm going to talk about the data, but it's from a very large area that we have mapped. Most studies throw the black hole away because it's very hard to model. But a new approach has been done by Jonathan Flores. I should say Jonathan is a graduate student who's about to finish. He's an NSF fellow and a Lambert fellow, which has been funded partly by the BOV, and he's doing great work. So what he has decided is to bite the bullet and use the most advanced code to model all the components of the AGN, and he's using TAC to do that. And so it's the first time we can actually look at luminous black hole and galaxies together. So the first result I'm going to show you shows where these most luminous black holes, think of them as the quasar I talked about earlier. Where do these black holes lie with respect to other galaxies? So this plot has a lot of information, but actually it's easy to digest, and you will see that in a minute. So the black stars here are these most luminous active black holes. They are accreting gas at a crazy rate. All the other green points here are about 30,000 other galaxies that don't have such black hole. And the red line here is the average star formation rate of these galaxies that don't have the black hole. So you can clearly see the average of the black point is going to be bigger than this red line because they're all above. And you can kind of see that there. If you actually do the average, well, the luminous active black hole clearly have more star formation than the general population of galaxies. So our conclusion is the galaxies with luminous black hole have higher star formation rate than the one without. So why is that important? Because it is telling us probably the same mechanism of fueling, of feeding this rapidly growing black hole and star formation in this galaxy. So it would be one way to grow the black hole and bulge together, which is this fundamental relation that we've been trying to explain for 20 years. So this is not the full picture. And it's also telling us if AGN feedback is happening, it's blowing the gas. It's clearly not doing it here. Maybe later, lower luminosity AGN might do it because none of these black points lie in the suppressed star formation regime. And then we said, well, why don't we see what the models predict? And we had a huge surprise, and that's the last result I'll show you. So what we said is, okay, This is the data I just showed you, star formation rate, mass, black holes, and other galaxies. So why don't we compare this to the top three models that are out there? These models need the black hole to regulate galaxy evolution, otherwise the model don't work. Well, it's been kind of mind-boggling what we found. This is the first theoretical model. It's called SAG. Well, look at this here and look at what the data is. Clearly, this is producing way too many luminous active black holes. These are the most, you know, actively growing black hole in the universe that we found. They produce way too many. But they do get the black line to be above the red line, so the star formation rate of the black hole is larger than galaxies without them, without actively growing. So they get one thing right, but clearly there's a problem. This illustrious model is from NPE and Harvard. They have, it's probably one of the most advanced hydro models out there. So notice they cannot make, this is mass here. They don't have any massive black holes. They only get active black hole in low mass galaxies, but they do get the red line above the black line above the red line. So one thing is good. Now SIMBA is another hydro model, hydrodynamic model, but notice one thing, it has no black hole here, no active black hole here. Its feedback is so efficient, it's blown so much gas that all these black holes have no star formation left. So feedback is way too efficient. And that's kind of what you saw in the simulation. They were just blowing out the galaxy. So none of the three models actually that are the top models out there are getting this right. So again, our hope, the models of course have a difficult challenge. Our hope is that this will guide the models and be able to do better. I'm just checking time here. So we have about 10 minutes left, and I will just mention quickly our future work. So obviously we will be iterating with the theories and tell them, look, this is where you are getting it wrong. Go back to the drawing board and try. But what we want to also do is, now I told you this, all the science we've been doing is actually in a field called SHELA, which is within the HEDDEX field. HEDDEX is a blind survey that we are doing at the observatory. And we want to get merger rates, and we will need the HEDDEX survey to do that. Because we've gotten merger rates 7 billion years ago, we are now pushing back further in time, and we can't do it with our data. HEDDEX will also show this filament, the galaxy in cosmic web emission, and we will try to find galaxy growth at the intersection of the filaments. We will also explore the effect of environment, which is one of the things I told you. Today, when you look at low density environment, so think of the countryside, and the high density environment, think of the city center, look at how different they look. One has galaxies like the Milky Way, the other has no galaxy like the Milky Way. So why do these environment become lead to such different evolution? And looking back in time where we can disentangle some of these effects is something we want to do with HEDDEX. And this work is being led by Kay Guo. She just started as a first year grad student and has started to delve in the data. 10% of SHELA is covered by HEDDEX. We will also do some work with the Giant Magellan Telescope. You know, this is the world's largest optical infrared telescope at commissioning. It's called a 30 meter class telescope because it has a very big aperture, 25 meter. Typical telescope today have 10 meters. So this is way big, way larger. It will be made of 7 mirror. And just so you look at the size, here's one human being on one telescope, one dish, one of these 7. Also look at the size of the UT tower will be the size of the telescope. That's about 30 meters there. So because it's so big, it will be very sensitive. It will be able to, it will allow us to look at really faint things. But because it's so big, it will also give us incredibly sharp images. You saw how beautiful these Hubble images were, right? In the GEM survey. Well, this one will be 10 times sharper. So it will really transform galaxy evolution. And I'm going to illustrate this here. Suppose this is an image of a galaxy that you observe from the ground. This is what you will get with GMT. Because it is so, this shows the resolution, the sharp images. This one shows the sensitivity. James Webb at the moment, that's the field of view. This is Keck, the largest ground telescope, and GMT will have much bigger field of view. So if you're looking at really, really distant galaxies, these two can observe maybe 3 to 4 at once, and GMT will observe 50. And you obviously need statistics to understand, to have statistically significant results. It's nice to observe distant galaxies, but I'm interested in galaxy mergers. So with galaxy mergers, again, we will be able to see much fainter system. A system like this, if you move it to redshift to the stage where the universe is really young, everything gets dimmed out. You can't really see. I mean, here you can say it's a merger, but at this epoch, you couldn't even see because the double nuclei here, they are just blurred into one here. With GMT, it will be the first time you can actually get this system and separate their nuclei, because the resolution will be 80 parsec and the nuclei is separated by 300. With Hubble, your resolution is 800, so you cannot separate this. So that would be fantastic. We will also be able to look at black holes to larger distances, because the gravitational radius depends on the mass and the distance. And you will also be able to look at the AGN feedback question in more detail through spectroscopy to really understand, is it real? What is it that the models are getting wrong? What further constraint can we provide? So at this point, I am going to shift to the last kind of broader outreach part of my talk. So I hope you will bear with me here, but I think that we are all still under unprecedented challenges with the pandemic, and we are still all processing our individual experience in different ways. And for me too, I think, this pandemic has caused a lot of inner reflection about many things. The relationship between science, between higher ed and society is one of the things that I've been thinking about. And to me, there are certain issues that have been clearly highlighted by the pandemic, and these are just my early thought. Clearly, no one will deny the crucial role of science in advising society, right? Clearly, science has basically saved lives and livelihood. The vaccine, the health protocol, and so on and so forth. But also one thing that it has, that the pandemic has really highlighted, is that most of the breakthrough that allowed us to handle the pandemic and potentially overcome it have not come from private sector and private lab. They have come in research universities. And so that's been a really eye-opening things for research university as they get funding for science, but also understand their mission. So for example, spike protein, genetic scissors, mRNA technology have all been developed in research university. Jason McClellan here at UT did work on spike protein. Jennifer Doudna at UC Berkeley got the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for foundational work. Laurel Ansel Myers at UT did a lot of work in biostatistical modeling to advise the state of Texas, to advise CDC and the federal government. And also there's been powerful instructional teaching method and mentoring method that have come out of COVID, partnership between universities and the Dell Foundation, for example, to use smart technology to do better mentoring in a scalable way so you can reach more students. So that's been another thing that's been highlighted by the pandemic. Importance of higher education and college degree. Prior to the pandemic, there was so much discussion as to whether one needs a college degree, as to whether in-person universities are going to disappear. And clearly this has not happened. Clearly now we really value higher education as a tool for socioeconomic mobility. The percentage of unemployment was much, much lower in the pandemic with those having a college degree. The ability to work from home was 2 times higher for those with a degrees. clearly, I think, just talk to the student, they want in-person learning. So that's been kind of a reckoning that clearly we do need not just higher education, college degree, but in-person learning. That being said, teaching and learning communities is something we have to rethink about, how to keep what we love in person, but also some of the wonderful features of online learning. I was surprised how much of these online learning features are useful for inclusive practices. So we are now at the stage of trying to find the best of both worlds and reaching communities that could not be accessed in the past. And finally, I think the pandemic has really produced disparate impact on underserved community, and it's more important than ever to build inclusive STEM communities. And I will show you just in closing some of the wonderful things that I'm so proud our department is doing to do this. And finally, this I'm going to just say that disinformation crisis is the most serious crisis in our society right now. If you can't separate facts from disinformation, there is nothing you can really do. And the solution to that will come, I think, partly, I mean, it's a big problem, obviously, but it will come through scientific tools to separate facts from disinformation. But it needs something more. It needs these different echo chambers and bubbles to talk to each other. So we really need to show empathy and to build bridges of empathy and dialogue with communities and segments that we do not speak to usually. We can't have a society where we are all in our individual bubble. So empathy gap is something we really need to think about as scientists and I think as society. So I will close by just showing you some of the things that we are doing for building inclusive STEM communities. So just this point here. So students are women, girls, and people of color underrepresented at all levels of the STEM pipeline. And this isn't, it's just not right that the STEM journey is not for everyone, but also for our nation to be competitive, we need to produce over 1 million STEM graduates. And the US is not going to get there unless we tap into the full pool of excellence. And so what are we doing? We are actually working on all levels here in the department, mostly volunteering our time. K-12 engagement, we do Girls' Day here to really address this thing that social and environmental factors really shape girls' belief in their ability in STEM. This is from the AAUW report. So Girls' Day bring 5,000 K-8 girls in the campus. And our Association for Women in Astronomy leads a lot of activities. This was 2019, this was 2020 in February, a few weeks before the pandemic lockdown. This is Anne here who came and learned in Girl Day 2019 and she then wanted to teach other kids. And our graduate students deserve a lot of thanks for leading this. We also do the professional development workshop at McDonald Observatory, and this impacts 30,000 K-12 students per year, which is fantastic. So that's something we are definitely continuing. We've also worked at the undergrad level, provide grad undergrad mentoring led by Drea, because mentoring is one of the most important things needed to keep underrepresented communities in STEM. Beyond UT, it's a privilege to be at UT to have access to a fantastic university with research facilities, but we wanted to open this door to students who are not as lucky. So non-UT student from underserved community or university with not so much research. So we have two programs here, NSF, RAU and Taurus, that bring kids, bring students, they're all my kids, but they're students, for the summer for 10 weeks. And here's the 2019 one. The students are so proud at the end. They work on research for 10 weeks and they present their poster. And again, this is something that postdocs, particularly our postdoc, volunteer their time. They're not paid to do this. It's really volunteering their time because they love mentoring. And it would be my wish list to do this across the state of Texas, but you know, it's above my pay grade. Anybody from the UT systems is interested in doing this, we would love to work with you. And finally, so this is undergrad, and finally at the graduate level, I wanted to mention a fantastic initiative to establish the Beatrice Tinsley Endowed Graduate Fellowship. This was enabled by the Heising Simon Foundation and Board of Visitor Member Ann Atkins. So I thank them for their generous gift. And this allows us to set up a graduate fellowship to honor Beatrice Tinsley. She was the first female grad student in our program. She did fantastic transformational work for her PhD. Her work was not accepted in the community at the time, but it turned out she was actually right. And it took over time, people certainly have realized that. She's been honored by the Astronomical Society, but we wanted to establish a fellowship for her here. So with that, I will end. I just want to remind you what we talked about. We described how galaxy growth is a very complex process, involves gas accretion, mergers, bars, star formation, and feedback. We outlined how a major merger can actually dramatically transform spirals into elliptical, and our own Milky Way will undergo such a merger coming near you in 6 billion years. We showed that, contrary to earlier work, when we look halfway across the universe, we found barred galaxies like the Milky Way are here. And that implies barred-driven evolution is important. It has had a long time to act. We also find the universe is actually is no longer a violent place for the last 50% of cosmic history. It's not forming star by violent event. And we also found when we look a little bit further back, 70% of cosmic history, we found that black hole have actively growing black hole, exist in galaxies that are also actively star forming. And so that implies you can grow the black hole and the bulge at the same time. But we found that the three leading theoretical models face serious challenges in producing the mass and star formation rate of galaxies. Although these models really need the feedback, clearly there's something not right. So we hope for significant advances there. And finally, I've just very briefly touched on this, but we need to foster an informed and inclusive community through science, empathy, and dialogue. So with that, I will leave you. And I wanted to thank you for supporting Texas Science and Astronomy, and end with this little symphony, which is my favorite animation in Galaxy. And this symphony, which brings Puccini's music together with cosmological simulation, you will see brings all the elements I've talked about, gas accretion, bars, mergers. Thank you. Okay, so thank you for your attention, and I'm sorry I ran a little bit longer than I thought, and I would be happy to take any question if you have any.
Thank you very much, Shardha. Let's show our applause remotely I guess we don't have that feature on this version. So a big virtual round of applause for Shardha. And Volker, our chair of the department, is going to moderate the questions. Thank you, Shardha. Thank you, Volker.
Thank you, Taft, and thank you, Shardha, for this inspiring talk. And now it is my pleasure to act as interface between the questions that the audience has typed in and you, Shardha, the speaker. And I apologize ahead of time if we may not get to everyone. We try to get to as many questions as possible, but given that we are a bit short of time, just in case we don't, apologies ahead of time. But Shardha, let me just start with the question. Earlier on, you showed a picture of an elliptical galaxy, and the question is that picture in any way enhanced because the questioner says it looks really luminous for a dead galaxy with virtually no star formation and massive stars? How can a dead galaxy appear so bright?
Mm-hmm. Okay, very good question. So when we look at galaxy and we talk about the light that is coming from the galaxy, we measure this light over a range of wavelengths. So at short wavelength, we are very sensitive. So ultraviolet and blue, we are very sensitive to the young stars. But we are also measuring the light from the galaxy in the red wavelength and in the near infrared wavelength. And those wavelengths actually trace the low mass stars. And so you will get lots of light at those wavelengths, the kind of redder end, yellow end, and near infrared end of the luminosity. So no, it's not really enhanced artificially, but there is one effect that I will mention. The galaxy I did show as an elliptical, M87, is a giant elliptical. So it is one of the most massive elliptical. If I had shown perhaps a smaller elliptical, maybe you would not have found it to be that luminous with respect to the spiral. So I think that's the answer to that one, but very good question.
Another galaxy is also in a similar vein, and this is right. You showed these different galaxy types, and so the questioner asks, why are galaxies so often dominated by spin and rotation? Why not other kinds of motion? Why is rotation spin so important?
So actually, in the two kind of galaxies we mentioned, in the case of the spiral galaxy, if you think about the way this spiral galaxy might form, you might have a cloud in the beginning that has a preferred motion, so it's rotating. So when that gas cloud collapses and forms a stellar disk, that stellar disk still needs to have angular momentum and ordered rotation. So you then get a disk and you have stars that are rotating. The spin angular, the orbital angular momentum is vertical, so you keep that, you preserve the angular momentum. Now, that's the case of spiral galaxies. It has rotation, it's ordered. In the case of an elliptical galaxy, it is actually dominated by random motion. So if you actually were to go and measure the ratio of circular ordered motion to random motion, for an elliptical galaxy, the circular motion, say, would be like 10 kilometers per second. The random motion could be many hundreds of kilometers per second. So in fact, nature kind of is a little bit more complicated. It has galaxies like elliptical dominated by random motion. And that partly comes from that violent relaxation process, because the violent relaxation happens when the gravitational potential changes so quickly. So it's pulling the star left, it's pulling the star right, up, down. The poor star after a while forgets its ordered motion. It just starts to move equally randomly in all direction. That's how you get a system that dominated by random motion.
Thank you. Now we have a question. Actually, this is from Kaylin Williams, our academic coordinator and BOV Excellence Award winner. So Kaylin, ask the following question. You argue that if two disk galaxies collide, they become an elliptical. Now the question is, can it also happen the other way around? Can elliptical turn into disk galaxies?
Yes, Galen, very good. So indeed, that's a very good question. And I kind of, in the interest of time, I skipped. But suppose, let's imagine the following scenario. We are dealing with the early universe. We have small spiral disks. They merge together, you get something that looks, I don't know if you can see, but you get this center, right? This looks like a mini elliptical, right? So that's what you get when two spirals merge early in the universe. Now, if gas accretes around this mini round thing, it will form a disk. So there, what you have done is the inner part of the spiral, the bulge, you have built it through, you have made an elliptical-like bulge system, but then gas has accreted around it. And what do you have as a result? You have a larger spiral. So in fact, this interplay between a bulge configuration becomes a disk, then that disk now merge and you get a bigger bulge. It's a constant interplay. So indeed, Kaylin, you're absolutely right. We do go from spiral to from elliptical, mini elliptical, which is a bulge, to spirals as well.
Okay, now another question also inspired by the two basic shapes of galaxies that you introduced, Shardha, elliptical galaxies, spiral galaxies. And now the question is this basic effect whether a galaxy happens to be elliptical or spiral, is this defined by the kind of black hole that lives inside them? Do black holes determine the galaxy type?
Not quite, because the black hole, if you think about the scale, my phone is ringing in my office. The black hole, as we've discussed, they are, you know, very, very compact object, 10 to the minus 4 parsec or so. So they act as a gravitational sink where matter can pile up and form a galaxy around the black hole. But the black hole itself doesn't really determine the shape of the galaxy on large scale, whether it has a disk-like shape or whether it has, an elliptical-like shape. However, if I may, I would like to also to mention one thing here. It's not quite the question that was asked, which I think I have answered the question, but it's a slightly different angle. When I showed the relationship between the black hole bulge and the black hole mass, I kind of said, well, you know, they scale with each other and mergers could probably grow both a round bulge and a black hole. It's much more complicated because bulge have different shapes. So you might have remembered on the plot, there was something that was called a pseudo bulge. A pseudo bulge is not round and it cannot be really formed by mergers, but those pseudo bulge also do that black hole bulge relation. So the shape of the bulge, irrespective of its shape, correlates with the black hole mass, and mergers only work when the bulge is round. So your question about the shape reminded me about that complexity. So that would be another hour lecture in itself.
Now we have another question from actually Noah Gillespie. He is a new BOV member, just having joined today. So this is his first meeting. And the question is, elliptical galaxies, what is the long-term fate? Do they ultimately burn out since they don't produce new stars? What happens in the long term? Do they collapse, spread out? What's the final fate of an elliptical galaxy?
So if it depends, Noah, how long we talk about final, because one can show that the final fate of any galaxy in the universe will be actually a black hole. So it doesn't happen necessarily because they burn out and they don't form stars. It happens because of a number of interaction that happen in high density region between the stars. That kind of interaction can cause something we call mass segregation. So the high mass stars will start to fall to the center, the low mass star will start to be ejected out. That will happen in a spiral galaxy and in an elliptical galaxy given enough time. And when that starts to happen, the low mass galaxies are ejected, the low mass stars are ejected, the high mass stars are there. Then they will undergo a process called gravothermal catastrophe, where that stuff is continuously losing energy by evaporating its low mass star. And it is becoming more and more and more and more bound. And eventually it will have runaway collapse. It will become a black hole. So eventually the universe will be dark. But that time scale is very long. So eventually, yes, they do burn out, but perhaps in a slightly more dramatic way than we might be thinking.
Okay. Now, another question that is in the same vein as some of the other questions that I've read, if we play with this typical setup of the spiral, elliptical, and match them together. Now, the question is, what happens if two elliptical galaxies merge?
Mm-hmm. Right. So those are the one of these cases I mentioned about the dry mergers, right, where you have two ellipticals happen. So merge. So the violent relaxation process will still happen because the violent relaxation process doesn't care that there's no gas around, which is the difference. When two ellipticals merge, we have stars merging, we don't have gas. So we will not have new star formation, but violent relaxation will still happen because when these two things merge, the gravitational potential changes very, very quickly on a short dynamical timescale. So it's going to shake these poor stars all over again, move them randomly. It's going to increase their random motion. And at the end, you will just get a bigger elliptical with the stars having larger random motion. And that part will still be exactly as it was when you had a two-spiral merge. The difference is you do not form new stars in the process. You just randomize the existing stars.
It's slightly different, different kind of question, but of similar, mm-hmm. similar physics involved here. So the question is, it is interesting to see, says the audience member, that on the local level, we have galaxies collapsing, clumping, consolidating, but on the large scale, the universe is relentlessly expanding. Is the prospect of great crunch no longer seen as viable? What do you think about the great crunch at this time, given what you know about cosmology?
Mm-hmm. So I think the great crunch at this stage is considered pretty unviable. But maybe before I speak to that, I will just mention one thing. When galaxies are merging and so on, they are really responding to the local gravity. So for example, M31 and Milky Way, the respective gravity they're exerting on each other, they're not really moving under the effect of the Hubble expansion, the expansion of the universe. So in region where you have this dense concentration of matter and gravity, they almost operate independently of that larger global expansion that you're mentioning. But to your question about the big crunch, given what we know about the expansion of the universe right now, it's accelerating expansion. We believe late stage evolution is going to be dominated by dark energy, right? So the expansion will continue to accelerate. So I think the big crunch is pretty much ruled out at this moment, whether the universe will keep expanding forever or will actually, you know, be moved to larger radii, and how exactly that accelerating expansion will happen, whether we have the big freeze, for example, those details are still work out and maybe HeadDex will help us, but we still need to know more about the nature of dark energy before we can rule out the other two hypotheses. But the third one, the big crunch, is pretty much out at this time.
Okay, now there's a question that I have to pass on to you. This is from the other side of the planet, from your place of birth, Shardha Mauritius. Shreyan mm-hmm. asks, what will happen if a spiral galaxy merges with an elliptical? A question from Shreyan in Mauritius.
He's 11 years old. That's an excellent question. So I think we will have... the spiral galaxy will become an elliptical because again, the spiral will merge with the elliptical. You will have violent relaxation. So the poor stars in the spiral galaxy will become randomized. They won't be in a disk anymore. The amount of star formation you will have will be less because one galaxy is dead and the other is not. So the net new amount of stars you produce will be less in those systems because one is gas rich, one is gas poor. But the final configuration, again, the universe only cares that gravity, the gravitational potential is changing quickly, and stars will just be pulled left and right. So you will still get an elliptical, a bigger one, more random motion, and not that much more new stars formed in them.
Shardha, now a question from Laurie and Bill Pellerin. Obviously, right, spiral galaxies, typically they are actively star forming like our Milky Way. But elliptical galaxies have no star formation. So why is star formation inhibited in elliptical galaxies? Of course, they are after all made from, right, can be made from merging spirals. So why is star formation not happening anymore? What happened?
Okay. So I would, Laurie and Bill, nice to hear from you. So in this case, what is happening is the when two spiral galaxies merge, this merger process, what it is doing is it is accelerating the conversion of gas into stars, right? And this happens through for several reasons. One is you have these bars that form and these shocks that happen. So all that diffused gas that was sitting in the outer region of the spiral, and it would have taken so long for it to form stars, all that gas is now driven to the center. It is piled to very, very high density. And when there's a law in star formation called Kennicott-Schmidt law, which tells you the higher the gas density, the faster star formation proceeds. So effectively, during the conversion of two spirals into an elliptical, the conversion of gas into star has been accelerated. And so because of that, by the time the elliptical is there, all the spiral galaxies on their own would have taken maybe many billion years to form new stars. All that gas has now been converted into stars. So you end up with a system that no longer has any stars, any gas to form stars.
I think we have time for maybe two or three more questions. So one question is a fundamental physics question, Shardha. And this is basically, you and other speakers before, they have argued that active massive stars can ionize gas, create H2 regions. And then the question is, why can we be confident in modeling galaxies using just gravitational force, but ignoring the electromagnetic forces, say the ones exerted from radiation that comes from the central black hole? Why do we focus on gravitational force?
So this is interesting. So remember when I said that we focus on gravitational force to model the dark matter? And then I said that when it comes to modeling the gas, the physics is much more complicated. So when we model the gas and we are talking about the formation of star, the production of winds, feedback, it is no longer just gravity. There's a lot of complicated physics in there. So for example, as I said, you have to model whether the gas is hot, 1,000,000 Kelvin, whether the gas is 10 Kelvin or 10^4 Kelvin. And these different gas temperature and densities will lead to different susceptibility to form stars. One star formation happens, and then you have, in your simulation, you have the stars are producing, the massive stars are producing UV winds, UV radiation that ionize hydrogen, produce H2 region, and so on. You have to model the radiative transfer. You have to model the interaction with dust. And then let me just mention one more thing. I've said the models, this is a huge problem in galaxy evolution right now. If you don't put AGN feedback in this simulation and you run these mergers I've given you, by the time you reach redshift zero, you have produced monster galaxies that don't exist, right? 10 times more massive than what we see. So something has to prevent star formation in the theory model. And the theorists, as I've said, have said, let's just put AGN feedback. But think about what I've told you in terms of how small the AGN is, and the accretion disk is 0.03 parsec. These simulations, they have resolution at best of 10 parsec, 100 parsec. So how are they modeling AGN feedback? They are basically just making what we call a Bondi radius and a kind of circle, and it's making vague assumption about what percentage of the gas will eventually hit the black hole. And when you model feedback, you have to think, okay, I have light coming and winds coming from the accretion disk. I have now to eject matter. which means I have to couple light to matter. That's not an easy thing to do. Do you change that? Do you take that energy from the light? How do you convert it into kinetic energy to move the mass out of the galaxy? There's a very lots of complicated physics about kinetics, about angular momentum, about energetics, about coupling of light and matter. So it's very complicated, and this is why it's so difficult to get it right. A lot of the time the models will tweak. So for example, in star formation recipe, they will have, you know, a certain prescription. They tweak it so that they reproduce everything in the local universe. But now we go a little bit further back in time, the prescriptions don't work. Now, the cheating way to do this would be just to tweak your knob a little bit more. But you need to tweak your knob if you can explain why the physics is different. And so this kind of comparison that we constantly do with observation, first present day universe, then distant universe, it's meant to provide insight into the physics so that the modelers who have a difficult job to do can actually do all of these processes better.
Okay, so now I have one final question for you, and then I would like to share two comments from the QA that I would like to read to you afterwards, because I'm very sure you will appreciate them. So the final question is, and it's a proper question to wrap this all up. So the question is, are brand new galaxies still forming today, or are we done? Are we past the era of new galaxy formation? Is galaxy formation over, or is it still ongoing?
I said earlier on that in the hierarchical picture, we see low mass galaxies at early time and the biggest structure at late times. However, what I didn't mention is that low mass galaxies can still form today, right? Low mass galaxies are forming at all points in the universe. So if you have, you're not going to make, a really massive galaxies at redshift zero, but dwarf galaxies, ultra faint dwarf galaxies. These things are much, much smaller than the Milky Way. So let's say Milky Way is 10 to the 12, you could have something that's, a factor of 10 to the 1,000 lower in mass. So these things in principle could still, if you find a region in the universe where you have gases collapsing and you have a high density region, you have a black hole that's accreting, you could still in principle form low mass galaxies at the low mass end, but not the kind of galaxies that I have talked about.
Okay, Shardha. So now I would like to share two of the comments. One is from BOV member Frankie Holmes. Frankie says, thank you not only for the science, but also for the commitment to society. And then Frankie reminds us that Admiral McRaven often mentioned his fear of the vulnerability of K-12. And then Frankie says, I'm so happy you have such a comprehensive approach. I hope your work continues to expand like our galaxy. that was Frankie's comment. And then the final comment I want to share is actually from Pearson. Pearson, mm-hmm. Elter, Pearson has a professional background in music. So of course, he comments on your Puccini. So he says, what a lovely juxtaposition. In the original Puccini aria, Loretta sings that she wants to die. Beautiful, yes, to see this music instead coupled with the birth of galaxies. So, and with that shared comment, I think we should conclude the official Q&A part. And with that, thank you, Shardha, so much for this lecture, and thank you, Lara, and thank you, Taft, and thank you everyone in the audience, BOV members, but also everyone, students, public. Thank you so much for joining us in this great lecture tradition that we have had for decades. It's really a pleasure to interact with everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Shardha.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming.